Let us now join our hearts together in prayer. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. You are holy, Lord. You are like no other. Certainly there is none like you. Your thoughts are not our thoughts, and our thoughts are certainly not your thoughts. Father, we humble ourselves and we gather together today to worship you, both here in person and online. And we gather, Lord, seeking you to speak into our hearts, to reveal yourself and your will to us, seeking your guidance and your direction, seeking your peace and comfort, seeking encouragement that comes from you and your people. Father, we seek to know your call upon our lives and how you want to use us in ministry and light into the world around us. Father, we pray for the ministry and the presence of your Holy Spirit to be with us today. May your Spirit meet us where we are, Lord, and speak into our lives. If any of us are struggling today, we pray for your peace and your guidance and your direction. I pray that your Spirit will speak directly to our needs. And I pray that we will leave changed, being transformed by the renewing of our minds as we have met with you and sought you. Father, we pray for your healing touch for any of those struggling with physical healing, emotional needs, or spiritual needs. We pray that your Holy Spirit will move in a powerful way. Father, we commit this service to you. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Received a call this morning from somebody who was really just struggling right now, and that just spoke right to the needs and of the power of God in the midst of our greatest need, that God is there for us. So I thank you for that. Well, as we continue in our series on the Apostles' Creed, we're once again looking at the Holy Spirit. I believe in the Holy Spirit, and I believe the Holy Spirit's very important for the future life and the power of the church. The church can never do what God's called it to do without the accompanying power of the Holy Spirit. One of the great and good things that God has done for us is he has given us we are all grace gifted. He has given us spiritual gifts to enable us to do great and mighty things for him and to bring him glory. And this morning we're going to look at Romans chapter 12. And this is one of the great passages that talks about some of the, some people refer to them as the functional gifts or the motivational gifts of the Spirit, and he's going to list several of them. And as I've said in the past, we really don't have an exhaustive list of spiritual gifts. There are about four main passages that talk about different gifts, but in each case, the author writing, it's kind of an ad hoc list. He's trying to make a point, and he's using different gifts. Like in 1 Corinthians, Paul lists a bunch of gifts, and he says, now, this gift is given by the one and same Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit who gives the gifts as the Spirit chooses to give the variety of gifts to the people. And the purpose of the gifts is to build up the church, for the most part, with the exception of one gift, and that's more for personal edification. And he addresses that in the chapter. But In Romans, we have the Apostle Paul is laying a foundation about, it's a theology of our faith. He says, we're all sinners, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But God loves us unconditionally, and he sent his son to die for us. And Jesus Christ bore our sins on his body on the cross. And so Paul has laid down this theological argument. So the first part of the book, it's the head knowledge. It's the academic stuff. And he lays down a wonderful case for our salvation through Jesus Christ. And then as he comes in chapter 8 is a big significant. Therefore, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ. If you've accepted Christ as your Savior and Lord, we don't need to suffer from guilt and anxiety, because it's been washed away through the blood of Christ. And in chapter 12, he moves into more practical working out of this theology and this groundwork that he has laid. And our call to worship was this beautiful theology of who God is, that God is wholly other than we are. God's unsearchable. His past are beyond tracing out. Who's known the mind of the Lord? You know, who gives advice to God? We live in a world today where people think, you know, the Bible needs an update, an upgrade, and, you know, some people think they know better than God, and God's outdated, and so we need to update things. Well, this is just contradicts that. God's unchanging. God is perfect. And he is unchanging, and we don't need to update his truth. We need to follow and obey his truth and seek understanding of it. So anyway, that's kind of a long introduction. Moving into, he's writing to the church at Rome, people under Roman authority and everything, but he's writing in the midst of that situation. And because of all of this theology that he's laid down, therefore, Paul says, this is how you're going to live this out. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. He said a mouthful there in these first couple of verses. So he's urging us, because of what God has done for us, we don't deserve any of this. But in gratitude, we ought to respond by the way we live out our lives and offer our whole bodies as living sacrifices. He's talked about dead sacrifices, you know, the shedding of blood for the forgiveness of sins, and the whole Jewish sacrificial system of offering animals as sacrifice so God would forgive us for our sins. Would Jesus Christ complete that? He died once and for all on the cross. It never has to be done again. And so how do we respond to that? By living out our lives in gratitude to God and what he has done for us. We talk about living sacrifices. Well, I thought if you're a Christian, it's all about being blessed and what God can do for me. And he's kind of the Santa Claus or the genie in the bottle. When we need God, we call on him and rub the bottle a little bit, and he comes and gives us what we want, helps us out of the mess we've gotten ourselves in, and then we put him back in the bottle until we need him again. Or a backpack God, and we carry him around on our back until we need him and we pull him out. But that's not what it's talking about. Our whole lives being lived out holy, being set apart for particular purpose of serving God and pleasing God. There's a way we can live our life that's pleasing to God, and there's a way that we can displease God. And so He says, if you don't want to displease God, well, let me back up. This is your spiritual act of worship. Well, I thought worship was coming to church on Sunday morning between the hours of 10 and 11 o'clock, and I thought that's when we worship God, and that's what it was all about. Well, that's an important part. Gathering as the people of God, to gather, to offer ourselves to Him, to humble ourselves before Him, to acknowledge the great things He has done. That's an important part of worship. But to worship means to serve. It means to live out all of lives, from Monday through Monday through Sunday, Sunday through Saturday. It's the whole week, 24/7. We should be offering ourselves to God, and that's our spiritual act of worship. Worship is something that we do. It's not just something that is done to us or for us. It's not the leadership up here, the praise team, and me preaching, doing the worship for you. It's participatory. And I love what John Calvin used to think. I mean, when we had the choir up here, you know, we would tend to think that the choir or the praise team, that's the main band, that's the main group. But according to Calvin, this, what we would refer to as the choir, is the auxiliary choir. And this out here, the body of Christ, is the main choir. And the people up front help the main body to do, and they lead in worship. And the purpose of the praise team is not to point to themselves. The purpose of me is not to point to myself, but to everything, point to God and for His glory. And then he says, don't conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. If you're too comfortable in this world, you're too comfortable. You know, we tend to think that, you know, this world is all there is. But we need to remember the best is yet to come. And we're just aliens passing through. Even if we're here for 100 years, that seems like a long time, you know, for us. But it's just a speck, just a blink of an eye in comparison to eternity, where we will go when we leave this world. And we'll receive new resurrection bodies that will never age or face disease or face pain. And there'll be no more crying or tears or pain in this wonderful place that is yet to come. But we're called to remain faithful and to serve the Lord and to be obedient to Him until He comes again. So don't conform any longer to the pattern of this world. There's a lot of bad stuff in this world. We live in a fallen, broken world. And that's why we struggle. And there's evil in this world. There is bad things do happen to good people in this world and life. So how do we rise above it? By being transformed. And this, you probably know this word, is it comes from metamorphosis. Like a caterpillar being changed into a beautiful butterfly or a tadpole into a frog. It's this process where we are changed, we're transformed as the Holy Spirit works within us to mold us and to shape us into the people that He wants us to be. And that's a process called sanctification, to use a big theological word. And how do we do it? By renewing our minds. Because our minds are full of stuff of this world that is directly in contradiction to God's word and His ways. So don't conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, by filling your mind with God's word and seeking to live that out in our lives. And so then, once you do that, you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Do you want to know what God's will is? You know, we kind of struggle with that, don't we? I know I do at times, you know, some of these specific things. But for the most part, we already know what God's will is. The hard part is not knowing what God's will is. I mean, read the book and He tells you what we're to be, what we're to do, how we're to do it. for the most part, not in specifics, but it comes with a part of obeying and not wanting to do His will, not wanting to live it out. It's not so much knowing what it is, but rather not wanting to obey Him and do it. But so He's telling us here, be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that we're being conformed more and more into the image and likeness of Jesus Christ. And that's our goal. That's what we should strive to do in this life and in this world. So then Paul goes on, for by the grace given me, you know, I can't do anything in and on my own. It's by God's grace. I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the measure of faith that God has given to you. So he's talking about pride here. And pride is the root of our fall. With Satan, we'll get into that in a minute. But there's a story about the lion, and he's the king of the jungle. We all know that. Well, the lion was having, feeling good, and he just went out. And so he wanted to make sure that other people were aware that he was the king of the jungle, just make sure everyone knew that and understood that. And so he went out, and he skipped all the small animals. He went out to the first animal. He went up to the bear, and he kind of roared and said, who is the king of the jungle? And the bear said, well, of course you are. You're the king of the jungle. And so he gave a mighty roar of agreement. And he went on, and he found a tiger. And he said, who is the king of the jungle? He roared. And the tiger said, well, you're the king of the jungle. And he gave a mighty roar and affirmation. And so he went up to the elephant, and he got right in his face. And he said, who's the king of the jungle? And the elephant just kept on doing what he was doing and wasn't paying any attention. So he got a little bit closer and roared a little bit louder. And who's the king of the jungle? Well, the elephant suddenly turned around, grabbed him by his trunk, twirled him up in the air a few times, threw him down on the ground, stomped on him, picked him back up, threw him in the lake, tried to drown him a little bit, picked him up, and threw him out on the ground. The lion looked up at him and said, just because you don't know the answer to the question, you don't have to get mean about it. Well, that's pride. Sometimes we can never see who we are and to see our faults. Well, the Bible gives us several warnings about pride. Pride leads to conflict, it says in Proverbs 13:10. Pride goes before the destruction, Proverbs 16. Pride leads to disgrace, Proverbs 11. Pride ends in humiliation, from Proverbs 29. The danger of pride is what led Paul to this passage and this warning in Romans 12:3. Paul writes in verse 3, because of the privilege and authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning. Don't think you're better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith God has given us. That's the New Living Translation. We have a tendency to measure ourselves by worldly standards around us, right? We compare ourselves to others. We find others and who aren't quite as good as we are, and others who are better than we are. And we kind of compare ourselves along those scales. Those who are better looking than we are. Those who are better looking than they are. But sometimes we can evaluate ourselves too highly. We can think a little bit more of ourselves than we really ought to. Paul says we should do it by the measure of faith that God's given us. And while God loves us all equally, He's given us different gifts and abilities, right? Some people he's given more gifts and more abilities. The parable of the talents. You know, and it's what you do with what God has given you that's really important. The most important thing is don't take the talent, even if it's only one talent, don't take that and bury it in the ground. Use those talents and abilities not to bring glory to ourselves, but glory to God. And remember, that's one of the ways that the spiritual gifts had been abused, especially in the Corinthian church. Some people were puffed up with pride because they had some of the flashy gifts, and they thought they were better than the other one, said, you really ought to have my gift because my gift is really, really good, really special. And so that's where the danger of pride comes in. As Christians, we're called to evaluate ourselves according to the faith that God has given us. In other words, we are to have the right state of mind about ourselves and bringing honest judgment about ourselves. You can go to the other extreme and say, oh, woe is me, I'm not worthy, I can't do anything. And that paralyzes a lot of Christians, and they sit in the pews their entire lives because they think, I don't have any gifts to offer. And that's a pretty common theme, I think, that many people have. James 4:6 says that God opposes the proud, but he favors the humble. And again, humility is, it's not thinking less of yourself, it's thinking less of others. It's putting others before yourself. It's not puffing yourself up with pride, but it's using what God has given you to bring glory and point to God. In Ezekiel, I'll just kind of briefly go through that. Ezekiel describes the fall of Satan because of pride. And let me just briefly read this. Ezekiel, the prophet, is writing to Satan, you were the model of perfection, full of wisdom and exquisite in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Your clothing was adorned with every precious stone, all beautifully crafted for you and set in the finest gold. They were given to you on the day you were created. Notice that Satan was created. Satan is not another god. Satan is a created being by God. God is speaking here. I ordained and appointed you as the mighty angelic guardian. You had access to the holy mountain of God and walked among the stones of fire. You were blameless in all you did from the day you were created until the day evil was found in you. Your rich commerce led you to violence. And you sinned. And so I banished you in disgrace from the mountain of God. I expelled you, O mighty guardian, from your place among the stones of fire. Your heart was filled with pride because of all your beauty. Your wisdom was corrupted by your love of splendor. And so I threw you to the ground and exposed you to the curious gaze of the kings. Satan, whom God said was the model of perfection and exquisite in beauty, allowed pride to enter his inner being. And he became prideful in his beauty and in his role, and thus in his wisdom, and he became corrupted. He thought he was better than he really was. Because of this, he was banished and thrown from down to earth. Therefore, let's answer the question, or ask the question at least, what is pride? Now, pride in and of itself is not necessarily evil. You know, I think it's probably okay to take pride in our children's accomplishments and to watch them grow and mature and express, some of the things we've been trying to instill in them, to see them grow in the faith. And those are good things. And I think of Hannah and her performance, her senior concert, and you know, she just did a wonderful job and had just grown and matured so much. And my guess is she had a proud mama sitting there watching her. And I think that's fine and wonderful to see her use the gifts that God has given her. She prepares to use them as a teacher and training others. So that's not I don't think a bad thing. It can be. I've also known parents who their kids are the greatest, never did anything wrong, and go to an extreme, and that can be. That's the real pride. But I think it's okay for us, you know, at the end of our lives, and I think we long to hear that voice, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." You know, that's what we strive for in this world, and it's okay. You know, Paul talked about that. He was waiting to receive it. He knew his life on earth was about to end, and he was ready to go. Evil pride is pride that exalts itself in arrogance. And the Hebrew word for this type of pride had many meanings. One was like a surging pride, like an ocean wave. You know, you see that wave, it grows and it swells and it starts to come over and crash. That surging before it crashed, that raising of the pride before it crashes down. Pride grew ever steadily, more and more and more, just like with Satan. He became more and more arrogant as he looked around and saw who he thought he was. But this type of pride cost the mighty warrior of God, created for good things, and he was and will be eternally punished. Well, let's move on and look at this next section in Romans 4 through 8, where Paul is going to be talking about the spiritual gifts. So he's talked about, first, we live our lives as an offering to God, as a sacrifice to God. That's how we live our lives. God first, me second. You know, less of me and more of him. Just like John the Baptist, you know, I must decrease so Jesus must increase. And that needs to be our attitude. And then he's talked about the warning of pride. You know, as God gives you these good things, you have to be careful how you use them. So then he goes on to remind us that God has given gifts to each of you from his great variety of spiritual gifts. And so we need to manage them well so that God's generosity can flow through us. Well, there was a man who applied for a job as a handyman. And so when he went to be interviewed by the potential employer, he said, "Well, do you do carpentry?" Man said, "No." "Well, how about bricklaying?" Man said, "No." "Well, how about electrical work? Can you do any of that?" And he said, "No, I can't do anything like that." "Well, what do you have? Why are you applying for this job?" And he said, "Well, I live around the corner." So he's available. And sometimes the greatest ability is availability. 1 Peter 4:10 says, "God has given gifts to each of you from his variety of spiritual gifts. Manage them well so that God's generosity can flow through you." God wants every one of you to do something. So what is God calling you to do? Continue on where you're going. You know, for many of you, that's the answer. Keep doing, keep on keeping on. For others, it's maybe something different, something new that he's calling you to in your life. But anyway, what is God calling you to do? So let's look at this passage now, Romans 12, verses 4 through 8. "Just as each one of us has one body and many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given us." It's up to God. "If a man's gift is prophesying," so now he's going to list some of these gifts seven different gifts, and some people call these the functional or the motivational gifts. So if a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it's teaching, let him teach. If it's encouraging, let him encourage. If it's contributing to the gifts of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, let him govern diligently. If it's showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. Well, let's look at these gifts and just a little bit of detail, a little bit of definition, maybe some of the characteristics of people who tend to have these gifts. And this isn't an exhaustive list or anything, but it's to kind of give you an idea of if you might have this gift. These are perhaps some of the traits. And just as every good gift of God can be used in the right way, so can every good gift of God be abused and misused. And so there are some tendencies that people who have this particular gift, some of their weaknesses might be these expressions or living out of those gifts. All right, well, let's look at prophecy. The first thing he mentions is prophecy. Well, a prophet declares the will of God or a word from the Lord for a particular situation. This is not like an Old Testament prophet that's pronouncing a word like Jeremiah or Isaiah. It's not the office of prophet, but rather it's a role that a person hears from God to speak into a particular situation. You know, you're struggling with a particular situation, and here the word of God comes and speaks into this situation. And so a person who has this gift tends to quickly identify good and evil. They have a good gift of discernment, and they know right from wrong, good from evil. And they love good and they hate evil. They tend to see things as black and white. They see very little gray in things. And you've probably known people like this, and you know, everything to them is black and white. And they're often a little bit blunt. They're kind of frank and outspoken in what they say. It's not quite like this, but it's kind of like, thus saith the Lord. You need to listen to this. This is what God's word says. And they're passionate about that. And so they speak God's word with fire. Now, some of the problems is they tend to be judgmental and kind of blunt. You can use the fire to warm or to consume, and so you have to guard against that. Some biblical examples would be John the Baptist. Repent, change your way, be baptized. You know, it's you're a sinner. Repent of your sins, confess those sins. Or Hosea or Jeremiah or Isaiah or Jonah, all these would be examples. The next gift is serving. A server tends to render practical services. A server is somebody who they see a need and they go about meeting that need. They don't wait to be told, they don't wait to be asked, sometimes they don't wait for permission. They just go, they see something, then they go and do it. They easily recognize the practical needs and they're quick to go and meet them. Type of person has a hard time saying no. You probably know those people. You know, if you the saying, if you want something done, you ask a busy person. You know, they just can't say no. They go around, they help other people. And their greatest joy, they don't see it as a drudgery, but their joy is to help other people. They get fulfillment in that. Also, these people tend to be in the background. They don't want to be up here. You ask them to get up front and talk, and no, I don't want to do that. Nope. No, they want to be in the background. And this is probably one of the most common gifts. This is one of the greatest needs in the church. Those people that kind of work and do things in the background. They don't draw attention to themselves, but they go on. So what are some of the problems? They can be easily hurt. Their feelings can be hurt when they're unappreciated. You know, occasionally they have these downtimes. You know, I do all this, and what's anybody doing for me? And but also, they are the kind of people that have a hard time letting other people do things for them. You know anyone like that? You know, they're people that they're always doing things for other people, but when you try to do something for them, oh, no, I don't need that. Don't, you know, they're just uncomfortable with waiting for that to happen. Well, who are some biblical examples? Martha. You know, Jesus was right there, and there is Mary right at his feet, and Martha was in the kitchen, you know, baking the bread and preparing the meal, and you know, Jesus, can't you just have Martha come in here and help me? Mary help me a little bit, you know? She's doing the right thing. Sorry, Martha. There's a time and a place for everything. But Jesus said, those who serve are the greatest in his kingdom. What about teaching? Another gift. A teacher loves to research and teach the Bible and look for those hidden truths, and they love research and sharing that truth with other people. And that's I think that's one of my gifts. And I love doing the research. And sometimes my tendency is I'd rather keep going with the research and realize, okay, I've got to stop here and I've got to get ready to prepare to do the teaching. But a teacher tends to try to find ways to make the truth clear so it's understandable to others. Whereas a prophet really doesn't care that much that the word is heard. Their job is to get the word out. And that's exaggerating slightly, but their concern is, thus saith the Lord. Whereas the teacher said, do you understand what he said? Let me try to explain it, give you an analogy or an example. But they believe that once you hear the truth, knowing that truth and applying it in your lives, that's what you need, and that's how you'll find your salvation and changing your life. Once you know the truth, that truth's going to set you free. So what are the problems? Sometimes they're kind of hard-headed. They feel like they know the way and hard to hear other people's points of view. And they can develop pride in their intellectual abilities. Biblical example, of course, Jesus. He spoke like no other person. He spoke with authority. He said things no one else had said. And he used those parables and things to help people understand and to know, and sometimes to keep things as a mystery. And then Apollos, who apparently was kind of like a golden-throated preacher. And then, of course, Luke. You know, he gave us Luke and Acts to explain so many things that happened. What did Jesus say and do? And then how was it lived out in the early church? All right, moving on to encouragement. An encourager encourages personal progress. They love to encourage other people. They tend to be perceptive, and they know, they can just kind of say, hey, something bothering you today? And so they tend to be more alert in some ways, perhaps, than others. And so they encourage others. They push them on a little bit. You can do it. You can do it. Hang in there. Oh, what a great job. You're doing so well in that. And so they love to encourage other people and to push them a little bit further to do maybe more than what they thought they could do. They like to do personal counseling. And, you know, how can I help you? What can I do for you? You know, they're the kind of people that send cards. There's a wonderful lady in our church in Philadelphia, and she's still doing this, I think. She sends me stuff on Facebook about members and asking for prayer and things. But she had this wonderful gift of, she sent cards to everybody. When people had birthdays, when she knew things were happening in their lives, she sent them all kinds of cards. And sometimes people get this card. I got this card from Martha, and who is Martha? And she just had this wonderful gift of encouraging people at the right time. She loved to do it. Well, the problem is they tend to interrupt others in eagerness to give advice. Some of the biblical examples, Barnabas. His name means son of encouragement. And remember when Peter and John Mark were, they had this friction about what to do, go on in ministry or to go back and continue to look at all the churches, make sure they were doing okay. And they had this rift. And Barnabas was the one who said, you know, listen to him, go with them. Barnabas encouraged people to listen to Paul as Paul was once Saul and a persecutor of Christians. And so when he became a Christian, people had a hard time trusting him. But Barnabas, the son of encouragement, said, listen to him. It's genuine. His conversion is real. He's had an encounter with Jesus, and you need to listen to him. Okay, then giving. A person who is a giver eagerly shares their material gifts. They love to give. You know, they're one of the, you know, they jump in line when they know that there's a need. And often they go about giving secretly. They don't want people to know, you know, well, let's name this new wing of the facility after me because I gave a big deal of money. Often the people with, and those people are fine, but typically a person with the gift of giving would give an anonymous gift. But they just love to do it. They give freely of their money, their possession, their time, their energy, and their love. And they don't do it to draw attention to themselves. But they do it because they believe in the causes. They believe in the purpose. And they want to give glory to God through their giving. They're grateful because God has, oftentimes these people have the ability to make money. Not always, but sometimes their ability, you know, they're good business people. And they have the ability to make a lot of money so that they can use that money for the glory of God. And so that's a good thing. So they want to bless or advance the ministry. But they believe God is the source. It's not, look how much money I made, so now I can give it to other people. It's, thank you, God. How can I use what you've given to me to be a good steward? So what are some problems? Well, they can pressure others to give. And in a good way, like a person with the gift of giving might, you hear these things, of a matching grant. I'll donate anonymously $50,000, and I will match what anyone gives. I will match what they give. If somebody gives us $1,000, I'll match that with another $1,000. And so they're trying to encourage other people to give through their gift of giving. So another problem is they can tend to spoil their own children or relatives or those close to them. Some biblical examples. Abraham, you know, the father of the nation, he left everything in order to go where God was calling him to go. And then Dorcas, who was a merchant, and Lydia, people who God used to help support the early church. Leadership. A leader gives direction and leadership. They have the ability to express ideas and organize in ways that communicate clearly. They're often a visionary person. They can see into the future a little bit, and they can see how if we do this, then this can happen. And maybe they're good at developing a strategy. They're strategically minded, and they can see the overall picture, the big picture maybe. And a leader, a good leader, is willing to give others the credit. They encourage other people. They see something going in the right direction for their cause, for their goals, and they want to encourage other people to do that. And they don't really care about getting the direction. They just want the goal to be accomplished. And so some people just have these ability that the people follow them. You know, they're kind of like the Pied Piper, and people just, wow, this guy knows what he's doing or she's doing, and they follow them. Well, what are the problems? Well, they can be upset when others don't share the vision, and you have this tension, and they tend to drive themselves, and often leads to burnout. What are some biblical examples? Joseph. Didn't matter where he was. He could be in prison. you know, he could be unjustly, you know, thrown into a pit and sold as a slave, taken to a strange country, and didn't get what he deserved. But he always found the respect of other people. Joseph interprets dreams, and then Joseph rose to be a leader in Egypt that God used for his people in miraculous ways. And then Nehemiah, if you want to read a book, a biblical book about leadership, look at the example of Nehemiah and how he rebuilt the wall miraculously in a short period of time. But all kinds of leadership strategies there. All right, the gift of mercy or compassion. A compassionate person provides personal and emotional support. And there, it's similar to the person with the gift of helps, except the person with helps is more the material, practical side of things. A person with the gift of mercy is more personal. They tend to see into and what's going on in people's lives, and they care and they have compassion, and they notice, you know, I notice that you're upset, and they want to do something about it. They are attracted to hurting or distressed people, and they want to help and encourage them. And so they, you know, when Jesus, if you want to do a good study, find when Jesus had compassion on others. When Jesus had compassion, it was like a miracle happened or something very significant happened because Jesus had compassion. And that's what a person with the gift of mercy has. They take up other people's causes and they stand and work with them. You know, that's not right. Let's go and let's see if we can make this right. What are their problems? Well, sometimes they can take on the weight of the world and other people's problems and kind of weigh them down. Or they can be hurt. Their feelings can be hurt kind of easily as well. But they're the kind of people also, like the person with the gift of helps, that tends not to like to be in front of people. They're not the up front of people. They're the people that work behind the scenes, making those phone calls and looking to other people. The examples, the parable of the Good Samaritan, you know, the guy didn't draw any attention to himself. He saw a need. It was somebody that Jewish people don't typically hang out with, but here was a person in need, the Good Samaritan. He'd been robbed and beaten, and he took care of that person. Or a Jeremiah, you know, as God told him to prophesy all this stuff that's going to happen to the people because they turned away from God, you know, he felt the weight of that punishment and the consequences, and he's called the weeping prophet. Okay, well, let's look at an example, trying to put some of these things together, sort of like what we did last week. So the situation, the example, is you've got a neighbor who is sick and has been bedridden for a month. We all know people like that. Well, a person with the gift of prophecy will be praying for healing and strength and endurance for that person. You know, speaking God's word, God's with you, God loves you, God can heal you, you know, the promises of the Bible, kind of sharing those types of things. Well, the server is the one who comes and gives the meals, takes the meals over. Hey, let me just clean your house, run the vacuum for you, those practical things. Can I run some errands? Can I go pick up some prescriptions or that kind of thing, real practical type of thing. The teacher will bring over some good books and encouragement from the Word. The encourager will go right over to encourage with Scripture. God loves you. He cares that you're in this situation. He knows. And then the giver will bring food and other gifts, spending time talking and listening. The leader will find out what she needs and organize the neighborhood to help. You know, find a strategy to help, you know, develop the compassion ministry. Okay, we're going to bring you meals for this week and organize all of that kind of thing, make sure things happen. And then the compassion person with the gift of mercy, how are you feeling? How are you doing? And they empathize, you know, they're the person that wanna give you the big hug and to maybe just sit with you and just be there, the ministry of presence. Well, you know, as we listen to all these things, you might feel like you don't have very much. Well, what do I have to offer God? Well, it really doesn't take a whole lot. Because remember, God's the giver of gifts. But let's go back to it's the availability. It's sometimes the best ability. And you think about a small boy who had a little lunch that his mom packed for him, but he made it available to Jesus, and Jesus used it to feed over 5,000 people. When God called Moses, you know, you're going to go to Pharaoh, the most important person in the world, and I want you to say, let my people go. And Moses said, well, you know, I kind of stammer and stutter. I'm slow of speech, and here am I, send somebody else. And God looked at him and said, Moses, what do you have in your hand? Well, I've got a rod, Lord. Threw that rod down, it became a serpent. And all he had was a stick. But in the hands of the Lord, God used that to help deliver a whole nation from the most powerful empire at the time, because he made himself available. Martin Luther King Jr. once said, everybody can be great because anybody can serve. You don't have to have a college degree to serve. You don't have to make your subject and verb agree to serve. You only need a heart full of grace and a soul generated by love. Well, what kind of responses? You may be sitting there and think, yeah, you know, all that makes sense, but God. What are some typical responses, some excuses people use? I can't. Yes, you can. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I don't want to. Change your mind. Jesus said, not my will. I don't want to go hang on that cross. Nevertheless, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. Well, somebody else will do it. Ever had that thought? No, they won't. Besides, it's your job to do something. Well, I don't know what my spiritual gift is. Then find out. Discover and develop them. Well, there's nothing to do. Everything's already being done. No, it's not. The Horatio principle, it's so true in the church and most everywhere in life, where 20% of the people do 80% of the work. 20% of the people give 80% of the finances. That's often what happens in the church. There's something to do. Well, I don't have the time. Yes, you do. We all have the same 24 hours in a day. It's a matter of priorities and using that time. I'm too busy. Find a place on Sunday mornings, since you're there anyway. What can you do on Sunday mornings, Sunday after church? I don't know what to do. Well, find a need and fill it. There are many opportunities to serve. Well, I'm too tired. Wait upon the Lord and he will renew your strength. Well, nobody asked me to help. Well, I'm asking you now. And God's already asked you. There are many opportunities to serve. Keep your eyes opened and your heart opened. Whatever gifts we have are gifts from God, and we need to use them to bring glory to his name. We need to be serious about serving. If you don't have a gift, don't sit back and wait for a miraculous sign for God to use your gift. Here's your sign in Romans 12. Get busy and start using your gift. Maybe you just need to step out and start trying different things, and you may find out, that's not my gift. Or you may find out, wow, I didn't realize that. But explore, use, try some different things. Remember the parable of the talents. One man took his one talent and he buried it in the ground. And even that one talent was taken away from him. The other two, who had more talents to use, they took those talents and they used them and they multiplied them and they doubled them and they received more back from their master. So it comes back to a question of faith. What do you have the faith to believe that God can do through you? And God looks for faithfulness in little things. God wants us to be faithful in the little before he blesses us in the bigger things. Remember David, King David? He started out and he was a faithful shepherd. Even his dad didn't think he was worthy when they were looking for the next king. He went through all of his sons and said, "You have any more?" "Oh yeah, there's one little boy. He's out there. You know, he's the shepherd. And he's the one." So he is faithful with his father's flock. He is faithful in fighting Goliath. Whole army was afraid of Goliath. He was a giant. David went out and took a couple of rocks and slingshot and slayed the giant. Then he was faithful serving as a king. God blessed faithful serving the king, King Saul. And then he was faithful as king. And God blessed David because he was faithful in the small things first. Well, we need to be the church of Jesus Christ, a body that's serious about serving God through the gifts he has given us. Let us pray. Almighty God, sometimes we look around at the world and we think there are giants in the land and we're too little, we're too small. What can we do against this big problem, this big issue? There are giants in the land. But thank you that you have given us gifts and abilities to slay the giants around us. Father, increase our faith. Help us to see things as you see things, to see the world around us with your eyes. Give us hearts of compassion and motivate us. Lord, help us to look at and take a careful inventory of who we are and what you've called us to be and do, and give us a boldness to step out in faith, maybe just a little step, a little trust, and see that you will be with us to guide us and direct us and to use us. Lord, continue to mold and shape us into the people you want us to be. For we pray all these things in the wonderful and mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. As you go out into the world, know that the power of the Holy Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead, that same Holy Spirit is within you, empowering you to be and to do the things that God is calling you to be and to do. So go in that strength and in that power and make a difference. And we can help change the world and make it a better place. As you go, the offering plates are in the back of the church, and you can give as you have been given unto, or you can give online by following the instructions on the video. But go now in peace. Love your neighbor and spread the good news. Amen.